said, I did a show up in Shepparton about 6 years ago, one of the largest growers, suppliers, and they go to all the chain stores. And we're walking around the fields, we're talking, you know, acreage that beyond belief, it's the size of Melbourne district. And we're out there, and I asked the owner, I go, so when did you start? He goes, 1956, Calabrese, who's about 7 foot tall. I've never seen a Calabrese taller than 4.5 foot. You know, this guy's huge. His hands are like, ginormous, huge. And I'm going to him, so hey, your tomato planting, what brought you into growing tomatoes? He goes, I like tomatoes, I make a sauce, and I put them in the ground, and it hasn't changed. 50 years later, 60 years later, the way he grows tomatoes hasn't changed. And I look out in the field, and I see these crop sprays, machines, you know, around the place. I'm thinking, you've got to be kidding me, because back then, there was just manure. You might have had some fertilizer, because after the war, we've been taught how to use synthetic fertilizers and things like that. Well, he uses manure still, he reckons, but then you see the 521 special, you know, pallets of it in the store, those who know the fertilizer I'm talking about. There's stacks of that stuff going on there, and drums of linates, and all the other chemicals you can possibly imagine. Nevertheless, he's using them. Question, why? Because Mr. Coles and Mr. Woolies want me to. They want all the fruit to look the same. And how does that work? Has anybody been to a plantation to see how they actually process crops, tomatoes, whether it's tomatoes or apples? This guy's got a machine that brings in cubic meter bins on the forklift. Comes in, warehouse, the size of your garden center, plus more. And there's a line there, a conveyor belt, they tip the tomatoes in. There's probably about 3 ton in this bin, 2.5 ton, let's say. Tips in by a fork on a system, goes up this chute, and there's an elevated section, 15 people on one side, let's say 12, because there was about more than 10, 15 on the other side. And this conveyor belt is probably pulling about 20, 30 k's an hour. And that's pretty fast if you're looking at all these tomatoes flying past you. And it's about a meter deep. Now you can see all these different colored tomatoes going in there, different shapes and sizes. And these lovely ladies are doing this. And I've asked him, I go, what are they doing? He goes, they're picking out the seconds. I go, what do you mean? I can't even see the firsts. They're just flying through there. And he goes, oh, don't you worry, mate. They can see after 5, 10 years of doing that, their hands are like this. And they go onto this top conveyor. I go, and where do they go? Oh, they go for a second pick. And where do these ones go? They go through the photographic machine. And what does a photographic machine do? He goes, it takes photos of the tomatoes. Are you kidding me? Because from this large, wide meter, 1 meter chute, it narrows down to, you know, about 4 inches in, and one tomato at a time flies through this machine, flies through the camera, and it's photographing, I'd lie to you, probably 20 tomatoes per millisecond or something like that. Ridiculous figures. And it divides and it segregates the tomatoes into 24 different categories. Small, small, medium, 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 large, large, extra large, red, red, green, red, green, 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 red, 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 green, red, green. And it goes on, and I'm thinking he's pulling my leg now. This is on TV, and we're going through there, and you look down the other end where it does a half, you know, 90 degree bend. It's gone through the photo shoots, hits this conveyor belt, and as it goes through that particular tomato photograph with a red, green, medium, extra large, falls in conveyor number 3, bin number 3. Bang, you go up to bin number 3, they're identical. You can't pick the difference. They're twins, Siamese and everything. Just perfect. Yet, second plant stage. There's another group of people behind each bin picking out the ones the computer made a mistake or the ladies missed the first time. The seconds go back up again, the thirds go there, so there's a third grade. So this is the processing of this tomato plant, and the greens go to interstate, the real red ones go to your next door neighbours, basically your Woolies next door, the closest store, because their lifespan is very short. They don't hang around long enough, so they actually get onto the shelf quite quickly. How they produce them and grow them and all that is another story. But as we've done that, we've walked past this huge opening in the building, the roller doors opened. And as we walk past, now we've learnt there's grade ones or first grade, second grade, and there's the third grade. And I've asked Joe, first grade goes to Coles Woolies, second grade goes to your green grocer, your local grocer. Third grade goes to the cows because they've got a cattle farm. And they feed them tomatoes there and they make beautiful meat and sauce and whatever you call it. Not sauce, meat and milk. Sauce. We're getting there. I'm excited about the sauce. And I've looked outside this opening and these little mounds, you know. And in the morning, we met up with the owner at a little bakery early morning, about 6:45. That's early for my cameraman. And we're sitting there in the little bakery, and I've had I think it was a salad sandwich or something like that, and he's had his meat pie, something in the morning. And as we're sitting down to eat, owner walks in to greet us, and he looks down at my cameraman, Peter, and he goes, "You're not going to eat that, are you? You're not putting that stuff on that pie, are you?" He goes, "Yeah." He goes, "You can't have a pie without sauce." He goes, "Oh, mate." He goes, "What's wrong with that?" He goes, "Oh, don't worry about it. I'll tell you later." Well, later is when I'm walking past this opening in the wall, and I see these little mounds out there in the field, little piles everywhere. And I'm looking at it, and I'm just trying to analyze what's going on. They're quite far away, a couple of hundred meters away. And above them, it looked like, I kid you not, a cloud, a little cloud, but hovering above it. And I've called out to Joe, go, "What's that out there?" He goes, "Oh, they're the Great Fours." "What do you mean, Great Fours?" "They're the Great Four tomatoes, are useless." I go, "You're going to make compost." And I'm excited. We're going to see some composting going on with tomatoes and all this sort of stuff. "There's no composting to be made." He goes, no, don't worry about that." He goes, "You don't need to know about that stuff." He goes, "You've got to turn the cameras off for that one." I go, "You've got to be kidding me." Because not going to happen. And I've got my cameraman facing me. So tell us what's going on. And as I spoke about that, asked him about that question, Semi comes along, open end. Little front end loader comes along, starts scooping up the piles and the tomatoes back into the truck, loading it up. And as he's loading it up, that little cloud decides to go over the Semi. Okay, cloud, as you can guess by now, is just blowflies, whatever you can imagine, wasps and everything, hovering over the top. And I look at Joe and I go, "Hello, cameras. Where's that going?" He goes, "That's going to Heinz to make you some tomato sauce." And I go, "You've got to be kidding me." He goes, "Nah." I go, "What about all that stuff flying above?" He goes, "Don't worry about it. They boil it up so much you can't taste them. You won't even see them. They disintegrate." "You're kidding." He goes, "Yeah." And then right at that stage, I've looked at my cameraman, and he's like this behind the camera, freaking out. And that's a story we share with our students that come through the school, our cooking classes, to learn about tomato sauce. And that's just one of many experiences. No discredit to Joe. It's their job. He doesn't make the sauce. The Australian standards are so low that allows things like that to get processed. They're not the highest of standards as we would like to think they are, because they've been promoted as being Australian standards. I'd be pretty not impressed, if that's the nicest way I can put it, if I was just to work to those standards. Because our standards of living are much greater than that. We make our own sauce, we preserve our own veggies. They're simple, they're not hard to do, and everybody knows how to do it. We've just been, I suppose, brainwashed somehow to believe that it's all ready for you. We don't need to do that anymore. And I get confused when I'm walking down the street sometimes, because my wife and I, the kids, we struggle to go out and eat anywhere. We always complain about food because we even cook it ourselves. We love cooking. And when we're out there's always something wrong with the dish, or the meal wasn't right cooked, or there was some ingredient missing. But that's just us being picky. But the fact is that we have got a wonderful range of produce out there, and life skills, I suppose, talent and culture that we need to embrace and learn and bring back home. Practice in our own gardens, dig a hole, plant a tree in the ground, you know, plant a seedling. Every little bit helps. I feel a brick wall. No. That's enough. Thank you. Look, I've enjoyed it. Sorry, guys, I sort of stopped suddenly. I'm just thinking, if I start another one, I'm not going to stop all night. So I hope you've enjoyed. Thank you for the invitation. Do plant. And do make sure you share one little tip
6 years ago,
with the young ones today.
Largest growers, suppliers, and they go to all the chain stores. And we're walking around the fields. We're talking, you know, acreage that, beyond belief, it's the size of Melbourne district. And we're out there, and I asked the owner, I go, "So when did you start?" He goes, 1956. Calabrese, who's about 7 foot tall. I've never seen a Calabrese taller than 4.5 foot. You know, this guy's huge. His hands are ginormous, huge. And I'm going to him, "So hey, your tomato planting, what brought you into growing tomatoes?" He goes, "I like tomatoes, I make a sauce, and I put them in the ground, and it hasn't changed." 50 years later, 60 years later, the way he grows tomatoes hasn't changed. And I look out in the field, and I see these crop sprays, machines, you know, around the place. I'm thinking, you've got to be kidding me, because back then, there was just manure. You might have had some fertilizer, because after the war, we've been taught how to use synthetic fertilizers and things like that.
Well, he uses manure still, he reckons, but then you see the 521 special, you know, pallets of it in the store, those who know of the fertiliser I'm talking about. There's stacks of that stuff going on there, and drums of linates and all the other chemicals you can possibly imagine. Nevertheless, he's using them. Question, why? Because Mr. Coles and Mr. Woolies want me to. They want all the fruit to look the same. And how does that work? Has anybody been to a plantation to see how they actually process crops, tomatoes, whether it's tomatoes or apples? This guy's got a machine that brings in cubic meter bins on the forklift. Comes in, warehouse, the size of your garden center, plus more. And there's a line there, a conveyor belt, they tip the tomatoes in. There's probably about 3 ton in this bin, 2.5 ton, let's say. Tips in by a fork on a system, goes up this chute, and there's an elevated section, 15 people on one side, let's say 12, because there was about more than 10, 15 on the other side. And this conveyor belt is probably pulling about 20, 30 k's an hour. And that's pretty fast if you're looking at all these tomatoes flying past you. And it's about a meter deep. Now you can see all these different colour tomatoes going in there, different shapes and sizes. And these lovely ladies are doing this. And I've asked him, I go, what are they doing? He goes, they're picking out the seconds. I go, what do you mean? I can't even see the firsts. They're just flying through there. He goes, oh, don't you worry, mate. They can see after 5, 10 years of doing that, their hands are like this. And they go onto this top conveyor. I go, and where do they go? Oh, they go for a second pick. And where do these ones go? They go through the photographic machine. And what does a photographic machine do? He goes, it takes photos of the tomatoes. Are you kidding me? Because from this large, wide meter, 1 meter chute, it narrows down to, you know, about 4 inches in, and one tomato at a time flies through this machine, flies through the camera, and it's photographing, I'd lie to you, probably 20 tomatoes per millisecond or something like that. Ridiculous figures. And it divides and it segregates the tomatoes into 24 different categories. Small, small, medium, 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 large, large, extra large, red, red, green, red, green, 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 red, 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 green, red, green. And it goes on, and I'm thinking he's pulling my leg now. This is on TV, and we're going through there, and you look down the other end where it does a half, you know, 90 degree bend. It's gone through the photo shoots, hits this conveyor belt, and as it goes through that particular tomato, photographed with a red, green, medium, extra large, falls in conveyor number 3, bin number 3. Bang, you go up to bin number 3, they're identical. You can't pick the difference. They're twins, Siamese and everything. Just perfect. Yet, second plant stage. There's another group of people behind each bin picking out the ones the computer made a mistake or the ladies missed the first time. The seconds go back up again, the thirds go there. So there's a third grade. So this is the processing of this tomato plant. And the greens go to interstate, the real red ones go to your next door neighbours. Basically, your Woolies next door, the closest store, because their lifespan is very short. They don't hang around long enough, so they actually get onto the shelf quite quickly. How they produce them and grow them and all that is another story. But as we've done that, we've walked past this huge opening in the building, the roller doors opened. And as we walk past, now we've learned there's grade one, so first grade, second grade, and there's a third grade. And I've asked Joe. First grade goes to Coles Woolies, second grade goes to your green grocer, your local grocer. Third grade goes to the cows because they've got a cattle farm. And they feed them the tomatoes there and they make beautiful meat and sauce and whatever you call it. Not sauce, meat and milk. Sauce. We're getting there. I'm excited about the sauce. And I've looked outside this opening and there's little mounds, you know. And in the morning we met up with the owner at a little bakery, early morning, about 6:45, that's early for my cameraman. And we're sitting there in the little bakery and I've had I think it was a salad sandwich or something like that, and he's had his meat pie, 7 in the morning. And as we're sitting down to eat, owner walks in to greet us, and he looks down at my cameraman, Peter, and he goes, you're not gonna eat that, are you? You're not putting that stuff on that pie, are you? He goes, yeah, he goes, you can't have a pie without sauce. He goes, oh, mate. He goes, what's wrong with that? He goes, oh, don't worry about it, I'll tell you later. Well, later is when I'm walking past this opening in the wall and I see these little mounds out there in the field, little piles everywhere. And I'm looking at it and I'm just trying to analyse what's going on. They're quite far away, a couple of hundred metres away. And above them, it looked like, I kid you not, a cloud, a little cloud, but hovering above it. And I've called out to Joe, go, what's that out there? He goes, oh, they're the Great Fours.
What do you mean grade fours? They're the grade four tomatoes, are useless. I go, you're going to make compost. And I'm excited. We're going to see some composting going on with tomatoes and all this sort of stuff. There's no composting to be made. He goes, no. Don't worry about that. He goes, you don't need to know about that stuff. He goes, you've got to turn the cameras off for that one. I go, you've got to be kidding me. Not going to happen. And I've got my cameraman facing me. So tell us what's going on. And as I spoke about that, asked him about that question, Semi comes along, open end. Little front end loader comes along, starts scooping up the piles and the tomatoes back into the truck, loading it up. And as he's loading it up, that little cloud decides to go over the Semi. That cloud, as you can guess by now, is just blowflies, whatever you can imagine, wasps and everything, hovering over the top. And I look at Joe and I go, hello, cameras. Where's that going? He goes, that's going to Heinz to make you some tomato sauce. And I go, you've got to be kidding me. He goes, nah. I go, what about all that stuff flying above? He goes, don't worry about it. They boil it up so much you can't taste them. You won't even see them. They disintegrate. You're kidding. He goes, yeah. And then right at that stage, I've looked at my cameraman, and he's like this behind the camera. Freaking out. And that's a story we share with our students that come through the school, our cooking classes, to learn about tomato sauce. And that's just one of many experiences. No discredit to Joe. It's their job. He doesn't make the sauce. The Australian standards are so low that allows things like that to get processed. They're not the highest of standards as we would like to think they are, because they've been promoted as being Australian standards. I'd be pretty not impressed, if that's the nicest way I can put it, if I was just to work to that your standards. Because our standards of living are much greater than that. We make our own sauce, we preserve our own veggies. They're simple, they're not hard to do, and everybody knows how to do it. We've just been, I suppose, brainwashed somehow to believe that it's all ready for you. We don't need to do that anymore. And I get confused when I'm walking down the street sometimes, because my wife and I, the kids, we struggle to go out and eat anywhere. We always complain about food because we didn't cook it ourselves. We love cooking. And when we're out there's always something wrong with the dish, or the meal wasn't right cooked, or there was some ingredient missing. But that's just us being picky. But the fact is that we have got a wonderful range of produce out there, and life skills, I suppose, talent and culture that we need to embrace and learn and bring back home. Practice in our own gardens, dig a hole, plant a tree in the ground, and plant a seedling. Every little bit helps. I've hit a brick wall. No. I think that's enough. Thank you. Look, I've enjoyed it. Sorry, guys, I sort of stopped suddenly. I'm just thinking if I start another one, I'm not going to stop all night. So I hope you've enjoyed. Thank you for the invitation. Do plant. And do make sure you share one little tip with the young ones today for a better future. Thank you.